OMTG.
Thank you, studio audience. Wow, you guys are just too good for me. Well, I just want to welcome everybody. Welcome a big hooray for Hollywood. Welcome to OMTG show number 32. We are just steaming right along, kids. Now try to keep up. Now, before I continue with the rest of the show here, we're going to turn down our music just a little bit. Before we charge ahead with this week's show, I just want to give a special shout-out of love, hugs, and prayers to my adopted South Jersey Italian family, the Deluzios, in Delran, New Jersey. Now, our beloved patriarch, Frank Sr., is quite ill at the moment, and it's looking like he's preparing to leave this world at this time. So I'd like to ask all of you who are listening in and who end up listening to the show, after our live broadcast, to keep my wonderfully loving, loyal, and tight-knit Deluzio family in your thoughts, in your prayers, and give them as much love and support as you can send their way. Thank you. Thank you so much, guys. And Frank Sr. would want us to just jump right back into the thick of things and give a big hooray for Hollywood. Welcome again to all of you. And just let you know that, you know, tonight, kids, I just want to tell you, you know, if you've ever felt awkward or at a total loss in the world of dating, well, then you're going to fully appreciate this wonderfully entertaining web series, Wallflowers, created by this week's featured guest, Kieran Turner. And that catchy little toe-tapping tune that you heard just at the top of the show is the Wallflower theme song. Let's give it another listen here real quick before we bring on our guest. So let's go up and find our song on our little dashboard. It's like a little breath mint. It's just very refreshing. Do you hear that, kids? It's like this little refreshing adult beverage that OMTG is having at this very moment. You know, I was really worried. I'm like, oh, my gosh, I'm out of my favorite drink, my little vodka and cranberry. But then I remembered I had these little bottles in the fridge here at the JRC Design Showroom, which is, again, our host this week, is hosting us. We're allowing us to use the gracious, chic, current, and correct, fabulous space here in the heart of Hollywood. So in honor of JRC Design Showroom, tonight's show is actually brought to you by this lovely bottle I'm holding in my hand, if you could see me. It's called Chateau Bastor La Montagne, from 2007 in the Sauternes area of France, region of France. Now, Chateau Bastor La Montagne Sauternes, we'll just say they're our sponsor this evening, an Appellation Sauternes Contrôlée from 2007. It's the result of a natural encounter between an outstanding soil, a favorable microclimate, and uncompromising men. I haven't met too many uncompromising men in my life, just saying. Their Sauternes is one of nature's miracles, not unlike your host, OMTG. Chateau Bastor La Montagne is one of the best representations of this appellation, made from 80% Semillon and 20% Sauvignon Blanc. This well-balanced wine can be served as an aperitif or with blue cheese and dessert. I'm just going to have it as an aperitif, kids. That's all I'm saying. So, now, I just want to go back to thank you for our sponsor tonight, Chateau Bastor La Montagne. Now, Kieran Turner, the creator of Wallflowers, the writer and director as well, well, we're going to bend Kieran's ear just to see what pearls of wisdom that he can share with us about creating and producing a successful web series. Mm-hmm. And this week's Just the Tip segment is for all of you post-20s single ladies and gentlemen, 10 tips for dating in your 30s, 40s, and beyond. And to close tonight's show, this week's Jukebox 5 song selections are inspired, once again, by our featured guest, by his colorful career as a writer and director. But before we cozy on up to the charming and disarming Kieran Turner, I want to remind our listeners that if you have missed any of our previous shows, just go to Spreaker.com or Facebook.com/OHMTG and get your fill of conversation, music, and laughter. And every time you listen to an OMTG show, a gay angel gets an aftertime lifetime. Let's try this again, kids, because I'm looking at my board and I'm trying to queue up my next cue. So here we go. Okay, I'm ready. And every time you listen to an OMTG show, a gay angel gets a complimentary afterlifetime membership to Grindr, the Celestial Edition. Ooh. Oh, my goodness. Some angel's going to get lucky tonight. And so, you know, kids, we're going to steam right along, and guess what time it is? Guess what time it is, kids? That's right, kids. It's time for one of our favorite segments here at the top of the show, Shits and Giggles or Crap That Makes You Laugh. Now, this segment will make you think twice about asking for second at the dinner table. All I'm saying, kids, is I hope you're not eating right now. So put down your forks, your spoons, push that plate away. But hold on to your cocktail, kids. You're going to need it. You're going to need it. So here you go. Let me take a little step. Sweet, the Chateau Bessard La Montagne. But it packs a punch. And that's what OMTG needs tonight. Now, here we go. This week's Shits and Giggles, a Crap That Makes You Laugh segment comes from the headlines of HuffingtonPost.com's Weird News. Artist claims to have eaten his own hip. Says it tasted like wild sheep. This was really a self-serving art project. A Norwegian artist claims to have consumed the meat off his own hip bone, and he says it tasted like wild sheep, according to the local. Alexander Selvik Ringenschul, 25, was born with a hip deformity and had to have an operation to replace one of his hips. Now, he filmed the operation and displayed the removed hip bone at his graduation show at the Tromsø Academy of Art. Now, at the show, he told Norwegian newspaper Nordlys that he also consumed some of the flesh attached to the bone. The artist says he boiled the bone to remove the meat, then ate it with a slide of potato gratin and a glass of wine. Oh, okay, cheers. Everybody cheers. Now, that sounds tasty. I made myself dinner while my girlfriend was at work, and I just resolved to have this really nice moment with me and my hip bone. Who hasn't said that? Okay. Now, he said this according to the local, which I take it must be their little paper. Now, the local asked Vengenschul if his claim was a hoax, but he told them it's true. I guess that's due diligence. All they had to need to hear from him was it's true. So, he also said the process of, He also said the process of mowing down on his hip flesh was therapeutic. The hip bone had been such a problem for me for over 20 years, and it was just a way of making it better again, he said. Well, either way, It's probably for the best that the Neil was a solo affair. In 2012, Japanese artist Mao Sugiyama was charged with indecent exposure after allegedly cooking and serving his own severed genitals to a group of cannibalistic diners who paid about $250 each for the privilege. That's one for each of them, kids. Now, while Vangenschall stated the dish he served up tasted similar to wild sheep, other accounts of the taste of human flesh differ. A German cannibal and convicted killer, Armin Muse, said in 2007 that his human brethren taste like pork, but a little bit more bitter and stronger. And in the 1920s, journalist William Seabrook wrote that the human flesh he consumed while spending time with some cannibals in West Africa tasted like good, developed veal. Oh, my goodness, kids. All I'm saying is that stay away from your hip bone. I don't want to see any of my OMTG listeners gnawing on their hip bone. And that wraps up our this week's Shits and Giggles or Crap That Makes You Laugh. Well, you know, kids, I'm so glad that you could join us this evening and for getting ready for bringing on our featured guest this week, Mr. Kieran Turner from the wonderful new comedic web series, Wallflowers. Now, Wallflowers is a narrative comedy web series by our wonderful guest this evening. He's also the director of the acclaimed documentary, Joe Bryas, AD. Now, he has set Wallflowers, this witty, cruelly comedic, in the witty, cruelly comedic dating world of contemporary New York City. Wallflowers details the ensemble exploits of a tight-knit group of sassy, creative Gen X stragglers coping with the ecstasy and the agony of single life as members of a Manhattan support group for the hopelessly single. So I thought, you know, there are probably a few of us out there, a few of us stragglers out there, you know, in our 20s and 30s and 40s or so. So, yeah, maybe single at this time, and we're thinking about dipping our toes into the world of dating. And for those of us Gen Xers, you know, who didn't necessarily grow up in the world of the internet and social media, we're still kind of used to the old-fashioned way of wanting to meet people in person. So this idea of meeting people online is a little scary. So I think once we get into our little conversation here with Kieran, we'll get a good idea about what inspired him to create this wonderful web series, this wonderful comedy, and how we can all maybe, you know, get some insight and get some pointers on perhaps how we, those of us 30-plussers, who are looking, you know, for a little companionship and don't necessarily want to go online and just, you know, shop photos and get, you know, just make a booty call. Because some of us are looking for a little bit more substance in our lives. So let's just hope that what he has for us is some good stuff, kids, like our Chateau Best de la Montagne. But before we bring on our wonderful, charming, disarming guests this evening, let's just take a little musical break and let's shake it up a little bit, and let's make everything shake up, kids, and let's call it timber, because that's what we're going to do. We're going to take all our troubles, shake them off, and just make them fall away. Here goes, kids. A little inspiration from Kesha.
The bigger they are, the harder they fall. Yeah. Bigger than boys, I dig it out. I have them like
what was that, kids? Oh, my goodness. Oh, I guess you know what that means. Well, if it isn't our featured guest standing right at the door right in front of me, Karen Turner. How you doing, Karen?
I'm doing well. How are you, Michael?
Oh, I'm fabulous. And I just wanted to ask you, how's my favorite little Alabama Hot Pocket doing tonight?
Do you think anyone knows what that means?
Oh, God, I hope not.
I know. I mean,
God,
I had to look it up.
Not.
I had to look it up, too. I was like, I wanted to think of something, I wanted to put something down that I had never heard of, and so I took a little survey on Facebook and asked if anybody had any good ideas, and what they gave me was just not cutting it, so I decided to go online and looked up sexual slang, and boy!
Nothing like the interwebs, kids. Ladies and gentlemen, Karen Turner!
And what an entrance, huh?
Alabama
Hot Pocket.
I know. We should give our love. Well, before we get, you know, why not start right in the depths of the gutter, kids? Yes, Alabama Hot Pockets. It's not a new snack that you're going to get in the frozen food section at Ralph's or at the Kroger's, kids, or the Piggly Wiggly, wherever you are in the country. So, so look it up, and don't blame me or Kieran. Don't blame us. Yeah.
It's a real thing. I didn't make it up.
True. Yeah, I know.
Doesn't
well,
it? It sounds. It sounds like a nice little snack. But boy, it isn't.
No.
Okay.
No.
Let's claw our way out of the gutter,
Michael.
That's
one aftertaste you'll never forget. You'll never forget. Now, I don't know if you were listening. I was going so fast, I almost ran out of material at the top of the show. You know, who knew? Who knew with me? So, but that's partly due to that our tonight's show is brought to us by Chateau Bastor La Montagne, this little bottle of wine I have right in front of me.
Oh, too bad we can't share it, but I'll let you drink it yourself.
Oh, wait, you can just reach right over and grab the bottle and pour yourself a little. I don't care. help yourself. Well, shove that at that Alabama Hot Pocket right now. I know.
Well,
thank you for
asking me to be on the show. I appreciate it.
Oh, my God, it's wonderful. Now, I just want to remind our guests, you know, that when we bring on our featured guests for these things, I want to remind our audience, that is, when we bring on our wonderfully talented featured guests, we like to set them right at the top. And not only are you an entertaining enterprise here at RMPG, we are an educational experience as well. So let's educate our audience on who this fabulous man who calls himself Kieran Turner is. Now, Kieran Turner, he's the creator, writer, director of Wallflowers, the web series. Oh, but that's not all, kids. That's not all. Kieran is also the writer, director, and producer of the acclaimed documentary, Jobriath A.D., which chronicles the life of 70s glam rock musician Jobriath, the first openly gay rock star. Now, the award-winning documentary film has played in over 50 festivals worldwide and was released to the... And that Chateau Pastor La Montagne is getting in the way. Okay. Okay. It was released theatrically earlier this year by Factory 25. Kieran is currently developing Jobriath's story into a stage musical. Let's give a listen. Let's have a little theater of the mind moment and give a listen to the official trailer of Jobriath A.D.
What you're about to see and hear is an unusual and exciting theatrical event.
I had been in rock and roll a long time, but this was something different.
When he first came out and the press got a hold of him, he was going to be the most sensational thing.
This young man is the act of tomorrow.
Flamboyant to the point of crazy. Yacht Queen Queen.
Answer me about homosexuals like Anthony James Brown, he's black.
Ladies and gentlemen.
There was something that was okay about a guy dressing a bit feminine. You know, you could be Bowie or Bolan, who were the most beautiful men in the world.
The hype was the new David Bowie, even more glam than Bowie.
I wanted to be famous.
We both wanted the same thing.
Tell me some of the business particulars behind Joe Bryant, what you have riding on it.
I got my ass riding on it.
Jerry Brandt was a serious operator.
And I'm a hustler. I'm a promoter.
Jerry Brandt changed his life.
The big picture was to make us the biggest thing since the Colonel and Elvis.
The launch for Joe Bryant was spectacular.
They had a gigantic billboard on Times Square.
His face was everywhere.
Take it over the top. That's my job.
He was presented his world like Athena born from Zeus's head, you know, a full-formed rock star.
It could not have backfired more perfectly.
Everyone hated him and was gunning for him.
Joe Bryant stuck his head in the mouth of the wolf and said, I'm the true fairy of rock and roll, and you could hear glass break everywhere.
You can be as gay as you want, but you can't say it.
Sometimes the groundbreakers, that's really all they get to do is break the ground.
A lot of people who are running around putting makeup on and stuff just because it's cheap. I just want to say that I'm no pretender.
Oh, yes. So we are getting baptized tonight in the world of Karen Turner. Karen, I know you're thinking to yourself, is he going to play that whole damn trailer? Really? The whole trailer?
And you did.
Well, yes. Yes, because you know what? Because on OMTG, we're not like your regular talk shows on the TV where they give you like a five-second snippet. I want people to really bathe in your talent. I want them to soak in it like palm olive, honey. I want them to soak in it like palm olive. And, you know, I wasn't familiar with your bias at all. You know,
right.
And being, you know, not the first out gay person, but I've been out practically my whole life. And so, mm-hmm. and fortunate, and coming from Canton, Ohio, that was not easy. so I really appreciate the fact that you've done this documentary and that you want to develop into a stage musical. So that's
well,
wonderful.
You.
So we thank you're
you.
Welcome.
Appreciate
now,
that.
For going, yeah, of course. Now, Kieran, little Kieran Turner, attended NYU, receiving both a BFA and an MFA in filmmaking from the Tisch School of the Arts. You're a little overachiever, aren't you?
Well, I kind of messed up in my undergrad year, so I kind of had to go back and do grad school so I could actually know how to do something. Yeah, kind of did, because I kind of went a little nutty when I got to college, and I you know it was sort of like the tail end of the club kid days, and I was out, you know, sort of like going to clubs every night my first couple of years of college, and you know was sort of exploring all that New York had to offer, and it wasn't happening academically.
Now, what was that one club that looks like a church in Harlem, Manhattan?
That's Limelight.
Oh, yes. Were you a regular?
No, I was – Limelight was sort of more like early to mid-90s. Mm-hmm. I was a little earlier than that because I moved to New York when I was really young, I graduated early and I moved to New York and, you know, was still a teenager and, you know, had like a year or so
from
before
16
I actually
to 30.
Started college. Exactly. So, mm-hmm. like, I had a year to sort of, like, you know, go out and meet people and explore the city and was living at the YMCA and working at Tower Records and, you know, just sort of, like, meeting whoever I could meet and all that stuff. So I was pretty much, like, already had a reputation before I started NYU, and
wow.
It was a little hard to let that go.
I guess you took the village people's advice when you went to the YMCA.
Yes, and it is not fun to stay at the YMCA, Michael, let me tell you that.
No, I think the mattresses are kind of old. They're probably not very comfortable.
Oh man, it was exactly. it was an adventure. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, I say there were probably many a night that you woke up and just one of us. Yeah. Be careful, kids. Oh, don't stay at the YMCA. It can be dangerous. Now, so you got your BFA and your MFA. Now,
yes.
Your first feature film, 24 Nights, which you wrote, produced, and directed. You are a multitasker, Mr. Karen Turner.
I am. Maybe it's that I can't work with other people. I don't know. But, yeah, I always take on too much.
Well, because you have a vision. And now this movie, 24 Nights, was made as your graduate thesis, but it took on a life of its own as your project seemed to be doing. And it played on the film festival circuit, playing in over 60 festivals worldwide. That's 10 more than Jobriath ID, but Jobriath is moving along quite well on its own. And it won 7 audience awards. 24 Nights won 7 audience awards before being picked up for distribution by TLA Releasing in 2001. Now, again, this is all about the theater of the mind tonight, because I think you'd appreciate that. Now, let's give a listen to the trailer of 24 Nights. Another magical theater of the mind moment here on OMTG. You don't mind, do you, honey?
I don't. It's fine. Go ahead.
Okay, thank you.
Dear Santa, my mother once told me that I could have whatever I wanted if I did 2 things, be good and believe. I'd like you to find me my dream man and send him to me. Now maybe you don't do that kind of thing, but I'm not doing so hot by myself.
I'm gonna live here forever. Crazy Uncle Jonathan, Jay Spinster.
Everyone, this is my boyfriend, Keith.
That is my Christmas gift.
Okay, Ed Asner is dating my Christmas gift.
Maybe Santa didn't really send him.
Of course he did. Too much of a coincidence.
I want you to lay off Toby.
But you're trying to steal his boyfriend?
Shh.
She ruins every single holiday. It's like having D-Mark for a mother-in-law.
I have to drink to make you bearable.
Oh, did you ever see The Graduate?
What seems to be the trouble?
I mean, are you stupid? This is the guy who's in love with you.
And when people see us together, they'll pull me aside and say, how did you wind up with someone as perfect as that? That's easy, I'll reply. I've been a good boy this year.
Yes. Ed Asner is dating my Christmas gift. Ed Asner is dating my Christmas gift.
That was painful. I'm sorry.
Oh, not at all. No. And another
for me, it was. For me.
No, you just drink up. It'll help numb the pain. Okay. Yes, and I love the line, I have to drink to make you bearable. I have done these on purpose, Karen Turner. I want you to know. I have played these on purpose because I want people to really be able to hear the quality of your writing, because I think you write like people talk, for one.
Thank you.
Which I think is not an easy thing to do.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. I try to listen to what people say, and it's not like I will transcribe people's conversations, but I really try to create characters that are real and believable. Primarily I try to tell LGBT stories, but I write all different kinds of characters. And really the only thing that they have in common is that they all come from a really honest place. I find complex characters so interesting and so compelling to write. And what I love about doing Wallflowers is that, you know, I've never really had a chance to explore character arcs this way, because I've always done films, and you know, it's done in 90 minutes or 2 hours or however long it is. And you know, getting to do two seasons of a show and getting to discover these characters, and also getting to know who they are by way of watching what the actors do with them, is fascinating to me, and has just been a really amazing learning experience. Like handing over a character to the actor, seeing what they bring to it, and then being able to write for that character, you know, with those things that the actors bring to it. I'm getting so like James Lipton, I know, but it's true. You know, it's such an amazing collaboration. It's something that I've never really experienced before, and I'm loving it.
I was just going to say that you are, now you had mentioned just a moment ago when I said you're a writer, director, producer, you're like a one man band, but you are collaborative, because what you do leads to collaboration. And particularly that this experience with doing this web series, Wallflowers, has really led you to be able to collaborate on a more continuing kind of timeline, as opposed to doing a film, which is a finite process, you know. And when you're doing a series that goes one, two, three, who knows how many seasons, it's wonderful to have that opportunity to have that collaborative effort going back and forth between you and your cast. So I think
that's
terrific.
It is really lovely. Yeah, I love that. I mean, I wish that we could have it even more in that, you know, a normal television series, they shoot, whether it's, you know, something for HBO where it's like, you know, 12 or 13 episodes or 10 episodes, or something that's on network television, which is 22 episodes, you know, they're doing a season over a sustained period of time. With a web series, at least with our web series, we shoot the entire season in one fell swoop. So, you know, it can make you a little hamstrung sometimes. You know, in season two, I, you know, worked with a bunch of new actors and really hadn't worked with a lot of them before, and wasn't sure what they could bring to their characters. You know, with Wallflowers, I didn't really have casting sessions. For season one, I just went to actors that I knew were good, that I had seen in theater, that I was a fan of, and I asked them, you know, showed them the scripts and said, I really like you, your work, and I'd love for you to do this. And, you know, luckily almost all of them said yes. Actually, pretty much all my first choices said yes, and then some of them dropped out before we started shooting. And I went to other actors that I also really loved, and I have to honestly say that I lucked out. I kind of lucked out, you know, in some instances by not getting my first choice, because my second choice, and I hate to even put it that way, like my second choice, it wasn't even that. It wasn't like I was trying to choose between this person and this person. It was, you know, again, no casting, but that person dropped out. I wound up having to look for somebody else, and it was just a fortuitous, you know, piece of luck that, you know, the people we wound up with, I felt like inhabited the characters, you know, in a way that I'm not sure I might have gotten from some of those early impulse castings. So that's been nice. But, like, for instance, the second season, we have this actress named Julie Abraham who plays a new character named Jane, and, you know, we sort of just threw her into being a regular right off the bat. And I hadn't really worked with Julie before, and I was only, you know, like another one of my actors recommended her, and I had seen her do, you know, like showed me like a little bit of footage of something that she had done, and I said, yes, she'll be very good. And I went to New York and I interviewed her, and, you know, I didn't ask her to read for me because I knew that she could act. But once I got her on the set, and I was just so impressed by the work that she did, but unfortunately, you know, I couldn't continue doing, you know, and developing stuff. And I got into the editing room and was watching her, and she's just so luminous, and she's just really just, you know, like the camera loves her, and she's such a good actress. And I kind of felt like, man, I wish that I would have had that time to develop you know, our working relationship and her character over the period of, you know, working on this and writing it through a full season, because I would have made, you know, more use of her and better use of her. And, you know, of course, if we go on to a season three, then I'll be able to do that. But, you know, that, and it's also, it's difficult because if something isn't working, you know, there's not much you can do about it within the season. You know, I mean, I guess you could go back and reshoot, but at that point it's a little too late, and of course it's costly and what have you. So there are benefits and there are drawbacks to, you know, shooting an entire season at one time. Are we kind of getting ahead of ourselves? I'm sorry.
No. Just for our audience who may be discovering Wallflowers for the first time, which they can find at Stage 17, that's stage17.tv/series/wallflowers, so stage17tv/series/wallflowers, produced by 8-Track Tape Productions, which is you, and Stage 17. Now, remind them, as they're going and discovering and watching Season 1 and then going into Season 2, who Jane's character, how she fits into the storyline.
Well, Wallflowers is basically, it started out as pretty much like a sitcom, as a comedy about a Manhattan support group for people who can't get dates. And that's sort of a really fine way to boil it down. But really what it's about is it's about this group of 30-somethings, people who are in their like mid to late 30s, who, you know, have somehow found themselves single at an age that a lot of people would consider past their sell-by date. You know, I think younger and younger people are expected to have success in every facet of their lives, you know, in career, in relationships, in, you know, where they live and how they live. And if you aren't set by a certain age in any one of those particular aspects of your life, you know, people look down on you and you're sort of viewed as a failure or a loser. And, you know, and I don't subscribe to that particular kind of thinking, but, you know, I know it's out there, and I've, you know, faced it myself in several different ways.
Well, I think your tagline really says it. Your tagline really gets to the point. They're more likely to be in a plane crash than find love in their mid-30s. But don't tell them that.
Exactly. You know, and because they are hopeful, but they're out there, and they're really kind of at a disadvantage, because this particular generation is the, you know, the last generation that kind of had to go out there and find, you know, make connections on their own and without the benefit of the internet. You know, and it's like, and now it's like, if you want a date, you don't even have to leave your house. And sometimes you don't even have to leave your house to go on the date, you know, and it's ridiculous. But that's, you know, there's a whole generation of people who are out there moving and shaking and have no idea how to go out there and make a personal connection if it doesn't start on a computer. And so you've got these people out there who are, you know, trying to navigate this new way of making connections and kind of failing miserably at it. Even if they get into, you know, some sort of a dating scenario, it's a wallflower doesn't necessarily have to be somebody who just sort of stands in the corner and is shy and doesn't talk to anybody. You know, it's also somebody who is just completely, you know, unable to sustain, you know, a working relationship because of, you know, some sort of a personality thing, whether it's just that they're shy or that they've been burned too many times, or, you know, that they're afraid to let themselves feel something. You know, it's, and our characters, you know, run that gamut, you know, people who are really, really hopeful to find love, and then the people who, you know, are wanted but don't even want to admit to themselves that they want it, and are battling themselves every step of the way, you know, to happiness. So I
have to say, I appreciate, as a writer, like I said earlier, is that when I want people to understand that it's a really big compliment to tell a writer that you write how people talk, because that's, like I said, that really is not easy to do. Because not everybody can be a writer. You know, people can call themselves a writer just like they can call themselves an actor. It doesn't make them an actor or a writer. So not only do, you know, like I said, there's a real naturalness to how your characters talk. There's a groundedness and an honesty And I appreciate that. That's really the through line of the heart of how you write, and the place that you come from, is that there needs to be a level of honesty, because you want people to connect with these characters. You don't want them to be caricatures, because I know that you and I both agree, as gay men, that we have seen enough.
Yes.
Stereotypical, hey girl, hey Nancy, hey Mary. And it's like, whoa, okay, there are people who talk like that, but not every gay person is that person.
Right.
So it's nice to have a cross-section of gay characters represented. And, you have a cross-section of humanity, period, in Wallflowers, not just gay characters. But the gay,
mm-hmm.
but the gay characters that you do present are very, very real. And I appreciate that. It's nice to have somebody
you.
That I can identify with. Yeah.
You know, and it's not even so much, I mean, it certainly is that there are a lot of stereotypical portrayals of LGBT characters out there. But, yes, there absolutely are people who, you know, there's an incredibly large range of people in the LGBT community and types of people and behaviors and attitudes. Mm-hmm. But I think more to the point, it's that a lot of the times you never see these characters, you know, because sure, there are a lot of people who are all like, oh, hey, girl, you know, and very sort of theatrical, but there's mm-hmm. more to them. You know what I mean? I mean, they're not doing that 24/7. But the thing is that you never see more than that in these character portrayals. And what upsets me about that is that a lot of people who are writing and putting these kinds of portrayals out there are, you know, openly gay filmmakers. And mm-hmm. it's like they don't even care enough to move past the surface. And you know, it's like I don't think we can blame mainstream media anymore for not giving us the kinds of portrayals that we want to see, because we're out there, we're making this work, and we're perpetrating just as bad, if not worse, stereotypes. So I really, you know,
it's not unlike, I think, some of the issues that the black community has with some of Tyler Perry's work.
Mm.
You know, some of the issues that they might have with some of the characters that he presents as well. So, you know, that's a whole other kettle of fish. But,
yeah,
you know,
I mean,
that's
very possible. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not my community, so I absolutely couldn't
right.
speak to it. But, I understand, you know, that's the case. I don't really think I've seen much more than one Tyler Perry movie. I don't know. I would not be the person to ask about that. But you know, yes, but there is some really good work being done out there, and I really feel like mm-hmm. it's being done in web series. You know, the last few months have really been paying attention to web series that are out there with LGBT characters and written and directed and produced by, you know, people in the LGBT community. And I've seen some really, really amazing pieces of work and creative things. You know, I've put together this this panel of queer-themed web series, or web series that have queer characters, and I've, you know, we've been sort of like trying to get it out there to LGBT film festivals, and you know, we're starting to get accepted, you know, into some of these festivals, because I really want people to see that. I think that this is, first of all, I really feel like web series and web content is the future of entertainment. I mean, it's getting harder and harder to produce independent work. Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Absolutely. Oh, I know.
Yeah.
To me, I think it's, you know, the future is something else at this point. I really think that web series, and people are starting to catch up to us. I mean, we're walking, you know, along with each other, arm in arm, and our community is really growing, because, as you know, I'm a part of a web series, Pretty, and I'm very proud of that show. And I'm just delighted to see, you know, over the last five years, the growth in the web series community, just tremendous. I mean, just this last Daytime Emmy Award, the Daytime Emmy nominations came out, and two web series that I'm familiar with, Venice, the web series by Crystal Chappelle, and and Divinity, created by Michael Caruso, who's a good friend. And I'm so proud of the both of them that these web series that are independently produced are getting that kind of recognition, because the shows like, you know, House of Cards and Orange is the New Black and this new show, a comedy called Deadbeats, with Hulu and Amazon and Netflix, I mean, there's a lot of money behind those, but like your show, Pretty, and others like Fumbling Through the Pieces and Divinity, as I mentioned, are, you know, we're slinging hash, you know, to put these shows up, you know.
Yeah,
it's, they're not
absolutely
paying for themselves. Yeah, so I love the spirit and what's happening, the level of creativity that's happening in the web series community is just amazing. And I was really struck at the quality that you're presenting, the production quality that you're presenting with Wallflowers, with your casting, with your writing. I think you're a very, very talented writer, and I look forward to seeing more of your work. What I'm really curious about at this point in the conversation, tell us how you managed to create, produce, and launch season one on your own, and then parlay that into creating the opportunity to team up with Stage 17 TV to produce season two of Wallflowers.
Sure, absolutely. Well, I had been on the film festival circuit with Jobriah Fady, and I was getting very frustrated with the lack of forward motion for the film. I mean, it took a while for us to get a distributor for the film, and you know, I felt like I had worked on this movie for 4.5 years, you know, between researching it and doing all the interviews and cutting it and such, and just getting it out there. And I wanted more to happen, and I was getting frustrated at how long this project took out of my life, and my God, was this all it was going to be? And I was in Dublin, and I was at a film festival, and one of the programmers had invited another web series, had invited a web series to show the first 4 episodes, and they presented it because I guess, you know, it just wasn't well known in Ireland, but he was a fan, he had discovered it. And I was there for the weekend, and I sat in and watched it. And, you know, all I had really known of web series before this was, you know, they were pretty shoddy affairs. You know, they looked like shit. You know, they were usually shot up against a white wall. The writing was usually a bunch of actors, and I, you know, put that in quotes, improvising. And the thing is that most actors can't improvise. You know, I mean, every actor likes to think that they can improvise, but it's a really, really special skill. And if you don't have a base from which to, you know, to jump off and improvise, all you're going to do is you're just going to sit in front of a camera and you're going to flail. And it's not going to be funny. It's not going to be entertaining. And that was the majority of what I was seeing: bad lighting, bad camera work, bad editing. And so I never really gave much of a thought to web series. But this particular show, it was called The Outs. And I was just really impressed by everything about it. It looked great. It sounded great. The writing was good. It looked like a television show. And I thought, wow, I didn't realize people were doing this at this particular level. And I thought to myself, well, wow, if that's happening, then I want to do this. You know, it's because it's something that I can do that I don't have to wait for the permission of others to allow me to do it. And that's basically how I've always operated with the things that I've done. Everything that I've tried to get done with other people where it's been them, you know, funding it or you know, basically giving me the permission to do it, it's never worked out. You know, and I don't know why that is, but it just is. And I imagine that there are a lot of other people who are in the same boat who are frustrated that they have to rely on the permission of others in order to get their art out there. It's a lot about what my documentary is about, what Jobriath is about, because that's all he wanted to do, and he was denied that permission because people were threatened by him, because he was openly gay, and, you know, because there was so much hype going on about him and what have you. But anyway, I wanted to do something that I wasn't going to have to wait years and years and years to come to fruition. So I went home.
Yeah, I just want to stop you just for one second, because I think this is a wonderful, wonderful moment. Just a pause. Just a pause. Because don't wait for the permission of others to do what you love to do. I want to thank you. I want to thank you, Karen. That's a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful mantra that we can all embrace. And, you know, every LMPG show, I hope for that one moment, that one sparkling moment, we have that aha, that kind of catches your breath. And I think that's wonderful that we can all embrace. Don't wait for the permission of others to do what you love to do, because you're a doer. And that's part of what attracted me to wanting to, and you know, to have you on the show, because people talk and talk and talk and talk, and they talk about trying and trying and trying, and then there's those who do. And I want to bring on the people who do to inspire others who have an idea and who maybe are a little afraid to take that next step, and hopefully this will help push them into doing. So, you know, thank you. Thank you. That's
well,
a wonderful,
that's
wonderful.
Really sweet of you.
Yeah, I'm
going to
put that on my vision board.
I should probably just hang up now, because it's probably not going to get any better than that.
Good night, everybody.
I know when to get out. So I went home, I wrote the scripts, and like mm-hmm. I said, I started, you know, casting about. I put together a budget. I got a friend of mine who I had gone to film school with, Michael Canzanero, to come on board and, you know, be my executive, you know, producer, co-producer, and help me sort of, you know, put the crew together. And I funded it myself, you know, and everybody got paid. And that's a personal thing. It's like if people, this is show submissions only.
your deserves a round of applause.
It's like submissions only. Yeah. Like, they're all friends, yeah. And they all work together, yeah. And they're a community. So, you know, like, whatever they do or don't pay, or, you know, like, didn't in the beginning, it's like that. It's lovely that there's a community of people like that who will work together and work towards something. I didn't have mm-hmm. that kind of community. So, I not that I didn't want to pay people, but I had to, you know what I mean? And so I wanted to, you know, to be able to do that. So I figured it out. We made it work, and I shot the first season, and, you know, we did 5 episodes in 7 days, something like that. And these are, you know, 15 to 20 minute episodes. You know, by March or April, they were up and running. You know, the first one had launched. So that's, you know, 6 to 7 months.
You know, you brought up a really good point earlier that I really hadn't thought of. Mm-hmm. I mean, as a writer, the challenge of a writer, you know, if you're writing for a standard, like, broadcast television show, you mm-hmm. have anywhere, like, from a True Blood, you know, 12-plus episodes or more for, like, an NBC, ABC, CBS, all those. And you have a chance to grow over a certain amount of time and interact with your actors and write and rewrite and all that. But, yeah, I mean, you really brought up a reminder. Not a lot of people who aren't immersed in the world of web series would realize this, that, yeah, when we shoot a season of a web series, we may shoot an entire season like one weekend or over 2 weekends,
right.
Or 3 weekends. But it's in a really finite amount of time that we're shooting an entire season, as opposed to shooting over the course of several months, you know,
yes.
Episode after episode after episode. So we don't.
And you get, if you're on a regular yeah. television show, you get audience feedback.
Right.
Especially with the internet, it's like people don't shut up. They're very vocal about what they like and they don't like,
yeah.
And you know that can sometimes help guide the writer's room,
right.
And seeing, you know, okay, people are not into this particular character. What can we do to fix that? Or maybe we just don't fix it. Maybe we get rid of them. Or, oh, people are really liking this couple or, you know, this character. Let's write more for them. And, you know, and it's like we don't have the luxury. But even further than that, you know, writing these episodes, and this goes for, you know, anybody who's, you know, doing a continuing storyline, you know, serialized as opposed to just standalone episodes, there's no formula. I mean, everybody's got a different length of their shows, whereas if you're writing a half-an-hour comedy or if you're writing a one-hour drama, there's a formula. There's an act break. There's how many storylines you should have. I mean, you can always deviate from that, but you know, there is a template that people follow and follow successfully, and there is none for web series writing. It's like you're hanging out there, you know, balls out, and you just, you know, you have to you have to really hope that what you're doing is working is going to work, and it's really trial by fire.
You're kind of writing in a vacuum in a way.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. My second season, I had to rewrite it 4 times before, I mean, like, really rewrite it. I don't mean just like doing patchwork or sharpening the dialogue or doing this and that. I had to tear it apart and rewrite it 4 different times because of actors dropping out. Once Stage 17 came aboard, they wanted to have 7 episodes instead of 5. So anyway, but I'm getting ahead of myself. So the show launched. We had it on Blip TV, and you know, I got some press for it. And these folks at this company, you know, had been casting about, looking at what was, you know, happening online in web series, and they really liked the show. And they called me in. Oh, I should say that I shoot the show in New York City, because I'm sure no one knows this. You know, that doesn't watch the show. And I live in Los Angeles, so that's another, you know, thing that's really difficult.
Oh, we're going to get to that.
Sorry?
We're going to talk about that.
Anyway, so this company is New York based. Yeah. So they asked if I would come and meet with them, but they didn't say what it was about, and I had no idea. I walked in, and they were like, oh, so we're starting this new online network, Stage 17, and we love Wallflowers, and we'd like to make it, you know, part of the platform. And, you know, what are your plans for, you know, for further episodes? And, you know, and it's a really interesting venture, Stage 17. It's a brand new digital platform, and it's by Broadway creatives, you know, and it's for them, but it's also for, you know, anybody who just loves really great scripted entertainment. But, you know, Stage 17 curated these wonderful writers and directors and actors and actresses, you know, who primarily make their living in the theater, and, you know, who don't necessarily have, a way to, or aren't necessarily getting cast in film or television, but who have a voice and who want to, you know, who are incredibly talented. And, you know, and they've given them this way to express themselves. And, you know, very few of the shows are about Broadway. You know, that's not what it's, you know, sort of Wallflower certainly isn't about Broadway.
Well, Smash,
but, you know,
wasn't exactly a realistic portrayal of how things. It was fun, but it wasn't exactly a realistic portrayal of how things work on Broadway. But that's okay. But kudos to Stage 17. Kudos
yeah,
to Stage 17.
Yeah, so they came
TV.
In and they really raised
the bar of the production values for your show. And it really,
yeah.
I mean, I right away I showed it to my boyfriend Luke. And we're like, wow, this looks like a network television show.
Thank
you. Really looks fantastic. So we as a viewer can really focus on the quality of the characters and the writing and the storyline and all that, and we're not distracted by bad sound, bad lighting. You know, to me that's really what you don't want any of that stuff to get in the way. And,
no, absolutely
that,
not. Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's you know, and
wonderful.
And season one had that as well. I mean,
right. Yeah.
I mean, yeah, we did. You know, but you know, that
good.
Was really, you know, season one. It looked very good. It sounded great. I mean, it was very professional.
Yeah.
But it was also a matter of finding the right crew, the right people to
yeah.
you know
oh,
the, that,
yes.
that share your vision. You know, as opposed to just coming on board. You know, as a hired gun,
yes.
You know, and that, you know, and sometimes that takes a little while. That takes a little while to find, you know, the crew who are going to go that extra mile because they're really, really into, you know, what you're doing. And, you know, we had a wonderful crew in season one, but it was just the people who we worked with in season two were just a little bit more invested.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see the difference. You absolutely can see the
mm-hmm.
difference.
It makes a
lot
of difference.
Wonderful.
I mean,
yeah.
I have to say, because my experience with Pretty, with creator, writer, director, just like yourself, Steve Silverman, was able to bring together quite a cohesive crew, and we were really, really blessed through four seasons so far of really bringing together the kind of crews like you discussed for your season mm-hmm. two of Wallflowers that really were on the same page with you and really helped elevate what you're doing.
Yeah. No, absolutely. And there were a lot of people from season one who came back and worked with us in season two who were wonderful, but it was just, you know, there were a few people that it just, you know, it was a different kind of a story. Not that they were bad,
sure.
but it's just, again, it's finding, you know, figuring out who those people are from season one who are on board and getting them to come back and bringing them and making them a part of it, and then finding the rest of those like-minded individuals who, you know, who are interested in making it something creative for them as well. Because it is collaboration. I love my DP. I mean, he's new for season two, and we really sat down and really, you know, worked as a team on how we wanted the show to look and how the shots were going to go. And it just ran so much, you know, more smoothly. And, you know, we shot seven episodes, 91 pages of script in 12 days. I mean, we basically shot a feature film in 12 days, and they were not
yes.
18-hour days. They were not where, like, you're on the set and you're like, oh, my God, am I ever going home? They were normal film days. And that's because everybody was working to their,
right.
you know, utmost potential, and they were professional and they were getting it done. So Stage 17 came on and they funded our second season, and they've been so supportive, and they really love the show, and they really kind of love the direction that it's taken, because, as I said, the first season was much more comedic and much more sort of sitcom-y, and season two is kind of turned more of a dramedy. And, you know, I realized that now that these characters are getting into relationships or sort of, you know, breaking out of their shells and exploring what scares them the most, which is what they want the most, it's not as funny. You know, I mean, looking for love is funny, but finding it and having to you know, figure out how to navigate it is terrifying and very dramatic.
Oh,
and,
tell me about it. Tell me about
yeah,
it.
Yeah, you know.
Because
so,
I have found the love of my life, and it is, it's a challenge for the both of us.
Yep.
It really is. I mean, you it's something you strive for, and it's very real, and you really present that. There's a lot of comedy, a lot of fun moments, a lot of, you know, great moments where, you know, as an Alabama Hot Pocket, as we mentioned earlier, in Wallflowers. But there's a lot of, you know, there are a lot of moments that are very candid and very just, you know, like, you know, they're not ha-ha moments. They're like,
right.
like the grit of life, you know, because
yeah.
like you said, it's a lot of different kinds of emotions. But speaking earlier, we had mentioned about getting the luxury of getting, you know, fan feedback. I'm hoping, I don't know what your schedule is like, Karen, but I'm thrilled that you're L.A.-based because the Hot as Hell web series Fan Fest, the second annual one, is happening in August in Palm Springs. That's why we call it Hot as Hell,
right.
August 8th to the 10th. So hopefully you'll be able to join us. We'd love for you to be able to be there and to get some hands-on interaction with some of the fans of web series who attended the event and who will be back again this year. I think it's a wonderful thing, and Steve Silverman is one of the producers behind this event. So hopefully you'll be able to join us. But because I think our fans, what's another aspect of the web series community is that the fans are very hands-on and very much involved in the producing and the shaping sometimes of what's happening in the community.
Interesting. Yeah. No. I absolutely was actually just talking to somebody about it today, and I definitely want to check it out. I had heard about it last year. I feel like this year I feel a little bit more, I don't know, qualified or, you know, invested in such, you know, because season one, I didn't know what was going to happen. You know, I mean, you just kind of do it and you don't have any expectations whatsoever. You know, I certainly didn't know that, you know, after doing season one in less than a year, I would go from, you know, paying for everything myself to, you know, it's like getting a funded show.
How wonderful is that?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's. I mean, I'm very lucky, and yeah. I'm very grateful to have gotten that opportunity. And it's sort of a, I don't know, it's like it's not even real. It's like it's a shock to me. It's because again, you know, you usually have to wait, you know, so long, and it's like and get turned down, and you know, and you go knocking on doors, and they came to
yeah.
me. I wasn't even looking, you know, for that necessarily because I didn't think it was a possibility.
I just want to know if our listeners who are tuning in, if they want to meet the disarming and charming and very, very handsome Karen Turner, you could possibly meet him at Hot as Hell, too. So if you go to Facebook.com, Hot as Hell Event, you can find out more information about that, and maybe you can be rubbing elbows and drinking some of the delicious cocktails in Palm Springs in August, because you'll need it. With Mr. Karen Turner, and OMGG will be there as well. So, you know, we'll be having some fun and debuting some wonderful blooper reels and new seasons of new shows. So I hope that a lot of people can join us. Now, I wanted to ask you, Karen, you mm-hmm. originally wrote Wallflowers as a pilot plus one episode, and then you kind
yes.
of set the project aside. Okay. How
yes.
did recreating the show format as a web series revive the project for you?
I had started, you know, being curious about writing for television like 12, 13 years ago and, you know, had written a couple of specs just, you know, on my own and decided to write a pilot. And I did it. It was okay. You know, it wasn't any great shakes. I just kind of put it in a drawer, and that was Wallflowers. But it was very different. And I really just kind of took the idea and from the pilot and really reconfigured it as a web series. I mean, when I had originally written it, it wasn't about this group of 30-somethings who, you know, had sort of like, you know, everything had kind of passed them by, or they, you know, were busy making other plans I forgot to get a relationship. So really only the idea of the support group was something that had stuck, and I really kind of wrote it from scratch. That's really all it was, you know, really based on. And I mean, I think my characters were much younger, because I was much younger. So I wasn't really writing people who were in their, you know, like approaching 40.
It's okay
mm-hmm.
kids to approach 40. It's okay.
Yes, it is.
Because some of us have approached it, and some of us have passed it by. All I'm saying. I'm saying. But I kind of see the show as, you may agree or disagree, and if you disagree, that's okay, because we like to tussle here at OMCG. I sort of see it as friends meets community.
See, I don't know community very well, because I think I've maybe only seen like a half an episode, so I will just sort of go, okay. But no, I definitely see the friends, the friends comparison for sure. And that's wonderful. I mean, mm-hmm. thank you. I mean, that was a great show. And certainly, you know, engendered a lot of, you know, wild fan following. So if we could mm-hmm. get like a fraction of a decimal point of a percentage of that, I would be thrilled.
I'll go for the whole pie. Who are you kidding? Who are you kidding? Now, I want to ask you, what was that like pivotal moment? Because I'm always interested in if there was a particular moment when that bing, that light bulb, you know, lit for the idea for the city, for the series, when it came to light. Was it a particular moment? Was it a TV show, a movie? Was it a moment in your life? And that idea for the show came to light.
I mean, I hate to say it, but I it was so long since I had written that first, you know, that first pilot that I mm-hmm. honestly cannot
remember.
Did you
forget?
I hate to say it. I did. Because, again, it was, you know, the original idea was just a little trifle that I wanted to see if I could create something on my own. And it was okay. It wasn't anything that I would have ever, like, even tried to put out of, you know, on my own or, you know, try to, like, use it to even get an agent. It was just, I did it, okay, back to the drawer you go. So.
Back to the drawer you go.
To tomb boulder. So,
right.
You know, so no, I just, it all just happened so fast, you know, like doing the web series. I really honestly didn't stop to think about it, which is probably a good thing, because if I really had stopped to think about it, I would have been like, you're spending how much to do what? You know, and I wouldn't, you know, wouldn't have done it. No, I probably would have done it. But, you know, it's,
you became your own Jewish mother.
Yeah, exactly.
How much?
Exactly.
To do what? You could have been a doctor. You could have been a lawyer.
Oh, believe me, I think about the house I could have owned from, you know, from the between the documentary and the web series.
Honey, forget it. You got a thick enough cardboard box and a couple of little boxes on the side. You have a condo. You're fine.
I have rent stabilization. I'm good.
Thank Jesus. Now,
I know, right?
Kieran Turner, do you consider yourself, as you say about the show Wallflowers, a Gen X straggler? And how much do you identify with your character's plight with the dating world? Discuss.
You know, it's funny. I had really kind of like taken myself off of the market for quite a while because I had really wrapped myself up in my career and, you know, and what was I going to do next? You know, I moved out to L.A. and oh, my God, why
you
am
really
I out here?
You really wrapped yourself in cufflinks and chains and cellophane, and you forgot your safe word. Let's be real.
Someone swallowed the key
your safe
and
word.
They moved out of the country.
Yeah,
you know, it was just... it was nothing. It was nothing that I was really, really placing any kind of importance on, and that was fine. I mean, or maybe I was just telling myself it was fine. I don't know. I'm not going to psychoanalyze myself. But I have
not
to say that
we've got time.
I won't
go
do it
for
publicly.
It.
I have to say that, you know, since working on the show, it was funny. I went out and I started to do some, like, undercover research, you know, like going on some of these websites. And, like, I made up, a couple of fake profiles, like one straight, one gay. And
that was you?
And, I mean, I have to say, it was really funny. I had initially, like, gone on one of – and I'm not going to name any names of websites. I don't want to, like, talk anybody down or
what's it
whatever,
rhyme with?
Or what have you. but I went on this one
Finder?
Website because I had been looking for to find out about maybe getting – this was before Stage 17 was in the picture – maybe getting a corporate sponsor for the second season. And I wanted to, like, figure out how these particular sites, you know, made their money. Like, was it a subscription base, or did they do advertising, or what the situation was? So I wasn't able to really find anything out unless I created a profile. So I created this bare-bones profile and, like, didn't put a picture. I maybe put an age, like, didn't fill out any of their questions. Or things or nothing. I mean, it was like no photo, nothing.
It was very bare bones.
It was very bare bones. And so, but, you know, and then was able to find out the information that I wanted to find out. Like a week later, I get an email from this particular company saying, hey, based on your profile, you've got these matches. And I thought, how the hell did you match me with anybody? I didn't say anything. And I thought, either this site is completely full of shit, or these are the 10 dullest men in the world if they're matched up with a profile that has nothing on it. But that made me kind of curious to find out, okay, you know, what are some of these people who are out there doing this? What are they encountering? What are they finding? You know, and so I did. I put my little private detective hat on and went in and just, you know, like, didn't make dates with people. I asked questions, and, you know, I really got a lot of really good information from that. But anyway, I started to, like, get curious, and I thought, well, you know, let me kind of see what's out there. And so I kind of, like, put myself, and I did. I created my own profile on a couple of these things. And
you're like the
you know,
gay Nancy Drew of the online dating scene. All I'm saying.
I think that's a great idea for a new web series, the gay Nancy Drew. She solves mysteries of relationships.
I would just call her the gay Nancy. You know. If they don't call you Mary, they call you Nancy, right?
Right, the Nancy Drew.
Nancy Drew. Yeah, you know, see, that's another brilliant moment. Another brilliant moment on the OMTG show. Here we go. Thank you. We'll be here all week. Yes, that was brilliant. So that's our show that we're going to create together, Karen Turner.
It's a great idea.
We're bound to work together. Now, I want, because this is the beginning of a great relationship. Now, Karen, as we mentioned earlier, you lived in New York City from the age of, from the tender age of 16 to 30, but you're currently residing in Los Angeles. Now, why did you decide to base the show in New York rather than in L.A.?
It felt like a New York show to me. And I, you know, I've lived in L.A. for, you know, a decade plus. And
you can just say, I lived in L.A. for years.
Yeah. Well, no, but also I didn't move to L.A. when I was 30. I moved to L.A. when I was a little younger than that. So, but I didn't want to correct you. But if it means that I'm going to you know, people are going to think I'm older than
me.
Damn it, I'm going to correct you.
What the hell? I'm not above learning. See, that's Beverly in the audience. She gets very upset when I make mistakes. So, yeah, that's okay.
I feel like the city is part of the show. It's like it's almost like it's a character of the show or it's an attitude of the show. And I don't know L.A. that well. I mean, even though I've lived here for a while, I certainly don't consider myself an Angeleno. I don't feel like L.A. is my home. I don't know it the way that I know New York City. And so it felt to me like this needed to be a New York show. That was one reason. But the other reason is I really, really wanted to work with theater and Broadway actors and people that I love theater. I've you know, worked in it since I was a teenager. And, you know, I saw so many shows and, you know, I love getting, like, discovering an actor that I've never seen before and just following their career and going to see them in whatever, you know, whatever it is that they do, if I really like them. And so that's what I did. You know, I approached people that I really, really admired and respected their work. Gibson Frazier, who plays Martin, he was the first person I approached. Yeah, he's wonderful. He's a wonderful actor. And
I really like him. He brings a lot of humanity to that role.
Yeah, he does. Because that role, it's a little simpering.
He's kind of schlubby.
He brings more to it than is there, I think.
Yeah.
And
he's very earnest.
It's funny when I had given the original scripts to, you know, friends to get feedback on, people said, "Oh, there are too many characters," and we think, you know, like the general consensus was the character you need to get rid of is Martin. He's not working for us. And I thought, okay, if Gibson says no, then I'm just going to write Marty out. I'm going to get rid of Martin. And Gibson said yes. And I thought, you know what? He and I are going to figure it out together. We're going to figure out how to, you know, take Martin and transcend whatever limitations are there in the writing. And again, it's like you're working with somebody and you're watching what they're doing and you're seeing what they're bringing to the character, and you say, okay, now I know how to write this character better. Now I know what Martin wants, you know.
He's sort of a Woody Allen type, but likable and doesn't mess with children or marry them.
Right.
And while we're paused with a little laughter, I just wanted to say, now, earlier, yes, I got the 16 to 30 from your director statement, Karen Turner. I live in Los Angeles full time, though I was a New Yorker from the age of 16 to nearly 30. Okay.
Nearly
30.
All
I'm saying is, I forgot the nearly. Nearly. So what's nearly 50, like 18?
Michael, I forgive you. I've moved past it. You need to move past it. We're going to be here all night.
I know. I'm going to put that shovel away. I'm putting that shovel away. I'm done digging that ditch. Moving along.
Good. We have a lot of ground to cover.
Yes.
So
you're ornery. I love you. I love you, Karen Turner. Now, yeah. So you're based in New York because really the culture and the lifestyle really is reflective of the series as opposed to the LA culture and lifestyle. But you also mentioned earlier that there about something about the acting pool in New York that you were just more familiar with that community, and something about that acting community, theatrical community, really appealed to you as opposed to the acting community, if to loosen using that word community. What's the difference between the community of actors here as opposed to New York? What's
is there a community of actors here, though? And that's just the thing. I don't know.
Question.
I mean, I know there's a lot of theater, but it's so spread out, and I don't know. I just maybe, you know, it was the familiar, and I knew these actors work, you know, and I knew I didn't have time to sit down and do casting. I don't know actors in L.A., and so if I was going to do this in L.A., I would have had to have, you know, sat down and done casting, and I knew what I wanted, and I wanted to work primarily with theater actors because you're on a very tight schedule, and you don't have time sometimes to really rehearse and do, you know, 100 different takes. You want somebody who's going to get exactly what you're saying, who's disciplined, who's professional, and who's going to go in there, and they're going to nail it, and they're going to know. And if they don't get it, it's just a matter of tweaking. And mm-hmm. That's what I get every time I work with this cast, and they're just, mm-hmm. they're absolutely wonderful. And again, I wasn't, like, the only person I knew beforehand, really knew, was Marcia DeBonis, who plays Leslie, the office manager. And I, you know, it's not like we were, like, friends where we were palling around with each other. You know, I knew her enough that I could approach her and say, hey, you know, it's Kieran. I have this. Would you read it? You know, where, like, I wouldn't have to worry that, you know, like, you know, I'm approaching some stranger. But everybody else, you know, again, I didn't know these people. So,
sure.
I, you know, and
so
I
just want to take this moment. I want to take this moment because I totally get your perspective, mm-hmm. and totally understand, because really what you knew best was mm-hmm. that New York scene, having done your BFA and MFA at NYU and the Tisch School of the Arts. But I just want to use this moment to just get, not that I'm the biggest cheerleader for Los Angeles, but I have lived here off and on since 1990, and I've seen the community here of actors grow over the years and the level of theater grow over the years, and there is as much theater produced in Los Angeles as in any other city in this country,
mm-hmm.
but because we're so spread out, and New York is 12x5, New York geographically is so well-defined, you get a greater sense, in a defined sense of community there, just because geographically it's so contained. And
mm-hmm.
it's a catch-22 here with Los Angeles, like you said. It's so spread out. You're like, what is the community here? It's really hard to define. So I understand that, and I appreciate that. But I also want to give a shout-out to that. There are a lot of New York, Chicago, a lot of actors from around the country who have gravitated to L.A., and there is a lot of wonderful theater that is done here in Los Angeles as well. But, hey, you're here. Who knows where the show is going, where it's growing, and who you'll be able to cast in your show in season 3, OMTG. So you never know. What was that? Why are you laughing?
No. But there's another point that I also didn't make is that another one of the reasons that I wanted to go after theater actors is because, you know, when you're doing something like a web series, especially, you know, something it's untried, there's, you know, it's a crapshoot as to whether or not it's ever going to get seen or anybody's going to notice it.
Right.
And people really have to take a leap of faith. They may like the script, but they don't know how it's going to turn out. And again, like, you know, history has basically, you know, has dictated, or it had, you know, at that particular point, that web series were pretty much hit and miss, mostly miss. And so you want to try and also find actors who it's going to be beneficial to them. If nothing were to happen with the web series at all, like if it never got seen by anybody,
mm-hmm.
at least my actors could have tape, and tape that looked like a television show. You know what I mean?
Right.
I mean, because everybody wants to get on that television series. Everybody wants to, you know, to make that sitcom money. And,
right.
You know, theater actors are no different.
But the same thing can be said about television shows. Most of them don't make it to network.
Right.
Most of them don't get past that focus group to get on the air. As
they don't,
pilot,
but most of them, you at least get paid scale.
not your SAG new media contract of $100 a day. I get it. I understand. That is very, very true. Because it seems to me that not only are you a smart, creative individual, you have a strong business sense about you. So, I appreciate that as well. So, kudos to you for that.
Thank you.
No.
So I wanted to offer that to them, and they were able to get it, you know, and more. So,
I have some really wonderful. Go ahead.
Sorry. Go ahead. No. Please.
No. You go ahead. We're like the Disney chipmunks. No, you. After you.
you know what? I forgot what my point was. So please.
Oh,
Michael.
I'm sure it was brilliant. Now I want to ask you, what's your ultimate goal? Since you're like a multi-talented, multi-leveled kind of individual in terms of the kind of creative skills that you have. Now, what's your ultimate goal as a creator, writer, and director with Wallflowers? And here it goes. As a writer, what messages or themes do you want to share with your audience, with your show?
I don't know that I've got a particular message with Wallflowers that isn't, you know, out there already. And that is that, you know, just because someone is, you know, past a certain age, it doesn't mean that they can be or should be dismissed. You know, we were talking a little earlier, but we sort of like wandered off, which is totally fine because I didn't really want to get into like the nitty gritty of it. But you know, again, I put myself back out there sort of in the dating pool like these past few months, and I've been getting out there and I've been going on dates and I've been, you know, sort of back out on the market. And what I have basically found is that if there's anybody out there, you know, who's my age and is out there, it's like we're sort of looked upon as damaged goods, because if there wasn't something wrong with us, then surely we would have found a partner by now, you know. And
men are all alike, 7 or 8 quick ones, and you're off with the boys to boast and brag. You better keep your mouth shut. Oh, I think I love him.
That's exactly what happened, yes.
Right?
Yeah.
I'm just saying.
Yes. It's true. But
right,
you know,
I know.
And that's just, it's just not true. And I've like found that like I either, you know, have to go out with guys who are, you know, 10, 12 years younger than me, and it's not necessarily what I'm interested in, because I want to meet somebody who has had, you know, similar life experiences, who, you know, as I have, who, you know, has been on, even if it's like completely different, I don't care, you know, like I don't necessarily want somebody who's in entertainment or anything like that. It's just, you know, I don't want to be a real life version of the Steely Dan song, Hey 19. You know what I mean? I don't want to be finding a guy who's like, you know, who, you know, and like I have to explain everything.
Nobody wants to babysit. All I'm saying,
I don't mean to be that reductive, because I have met some people who are, you know, far younger than I am, who are, you know, infinitely
amazing.
You know,
yeah,
amazing and wise and smart and,
right,
and just on it and with it. But,
yeah,
you know, it's just a generational thing. And so I hope that there are people who are out there, and if they see the show and they're like, you know, they're of the age of these characters, and they're thinking, man, I really screwed this up, and I guess I'm going to be, you know, a spinster cat lady for the rest of my life. And it's like, you know, no, you know, you don't have to be. It's you know, and it doesn't even have to be for relationships. It can be for anything.
And bitching and poking.
Right?
You know, I mean, even
right?
Even if it's a career thing. You know, it's like this. You should never. I mean, this thing, 30, 40 years ago, it's like people. You know, people didn't hit their peak until they were in their 40s. You know, career wise. And
thank
now it's like,
God.
You know, but now it's like every fucking magazine or media outlet has the top 25 under 25. I couldn't give a shit what somebody under 25 has to say.
I couldn't give a shit. I could give a shit until a paper bag, put it on their doorstep, set it on fire, and knock on the door and run. That. Yeah.
You know, and it's all like, it's like to me, like somebody who is under 25 and is worth talking about should be a wunderkind, should not be what we're aspiring to be. You know, experience
exactly.
and knowledge and wisdom are just, they're not praised anymore. And I want people to know that particular generation that's late 30s, early 40s, late mid 40s, late 40s, 50s, whatever, you know, you don't stop being a valid, vital person because you are no longer in a particular, you know, sexual demographic.
All you have to do is tune in to TV Land or Logo, whoever's playing the Golden Girls, 30 years later, tune into the Golden Girls, watch any episode, I challenge you, watch any episode, the writing is so fucking fantastic. That ensemble was so amazing. Those women were in their 50s, 60s, whatever, and beyond. I mean, come on. Come
mm-hmm.
on. And they were brilliant and vital and important, and that and so entertaining. So, yes, absolutely, absolutely. We're not discounting anybody in their 20s, but we're also saying that, ladies and gentlemen, those of you in their 20s, look beyond that and look forward to the rest of your life because there's some brilliance that lies ahead of you as well. So,
absolutely, absolutely. Just don't give up, you know. Don't let go, oh, my God, I'm 35, it's over. Because it is.
Oh, hell no.
Yeah.
Now we are ready for our next major segment in the show. Are you ready? Here goes.
When you hear the call, you got to get it underway. Word up. It's the call
word. Oh,
was that the actual version? Was that a cover?
No, that's the actual word up. Little snippet. Little snippet.
All right. It sounds a little like RuPaul.
Well, I love RuPaul. That's right.
No,
Tuesday.
Just oh my God! Could Larry Blackman and RuPaul be one and the same? It's possible.
They could. I've never seen them in the room together.
Exactly. There you go. Anyway, so I'm excited. Tell me what the next segment is.
This is our Just the Tip segment. Just the tip. How many times have you heard that, Kieran? How many times?
Far too many.
Just
far
the
too
tip.
Many.
Right.
Just the tip.
I thought I knew I liked you. Now, just the tip. Is where our featured guest, that's Kieran Turner, that's you, and I, OMTG, will give you just enough info to get you started. Now, after all, Kieran and I are entertainment prostitutes, not whores. We don't just give it away for free. There is a small shipping and handling charge. Now, our featured show tips this week are 10 tips for dating in your 30s, 40s, and beyond. All right? This is posted on Essence.com, EssenceMagazine.com.
Right.
Oh, honey. Mm-hmm. Now, number one of the 10 tips for dating in your 30s, 40s, and beyond is say goodbye to good-for-now relationships. It's easy to fall in the arms of the guy you've always been in a comfortable yet inconclusive relationship with. Although these relationships feel good, they take your attention away from finding a man who will put a ring on it. Discuss. What are your thoughts about that?
I don't know. I mean,
are now relationships.
Are people really looking to have a ring put on it at that particular age? I mean, is that,
well,
is that still really a goal?
Well, I mean, I think that's more like a metaphor. It's more like just. You know, it's like you're looking for a long-term relationship as opposed to a booty call.
I think you can have both. And what I mean by that is I think that if you've got someone that you can have a booty call with, that you can rely on for some hooking up, then perhaps, and you're still out there sort of looking for quality, perhaps it will keep you from jumping into something that you think is a little bit more than what it is, because what you really want is to get laid. So, Essence Magazine, I do not agree.
Oh, I love it when there's conflict. I love it when there's conflict with the just the tip segment. Oh, this is great. Okay. Number two, and that could be the Chateau Bertrand-la-Montagne talking, but who knows? Who knows? Now, number two, don't waste your time on bad boys. And when I heard this on our list, I had to play this song as an inspirational moment.
Give me a beat!
Is to have a crush on your thug, love, but when you're a bit older, forget about the bad boys. Men who behave badly are much less likely to want to settle down. Love should be your safe harbor, not the source of anxiety and bad boy drama. Discuss, Karen Turner. Are you going to disagree with this one, too?
No, actually, I am going to agree, and I'm going to go a little further out there, and I'm going to say
you go
that...
out there with your nasty boys.
Women and gay men do not like nice guys. Nice guys are shit out of luck. If you show any interest at all, it equates to weakness, and you might as well shut that shit down. And that's funny because it's one of my characters, Martin.
Martin's
the nicest guy in the world. And he should be, like, amazing marriage material, and he
absolutely.
He is not. It's like women run from him because they all say they want somebody nice, they want somebody dependable, they want somebody mature. They're all full of shit.
No, it's true. It's true because I was full of shit for a little while, too. It's true because my previous relationship before my beautiful, beautiful Luke was a very, very tumultuous relationship, and he was a bit of a bad boy. And it was just, it was 2.5 years of me really like dragging it out. And it was not pretty. It was not pretty at all. And yeah, you're absolutely right. So
I'm going to tell Essence Magazine what it is too.
Tell it.
Self-esteem. It's self-esteem, Essence Magazine.
Yes.
That's what it is. Because you don't have self-esteem. You don't think that you are worth having a good person in your life. So
that's
you,
true.
And plus, what it also with self-esteem is that you, if someone's not interested in you, if someone treats you like shit, if you can get their attention, it makes you feel like you're worthy. And if you can get someone's attention too easily, it's not an ego boost for you. It does nothing for your self-esteem, which is complete and utter bullshit, but that's just how it is. That's how it's always been. It's how it's always going to be.
Oh, you have inspired me to play one of my favorite sound clips. Here it goes.
I'm about to whip somebody's ass. Oh, I'm about to whip somebody's ass. Oh, if you don't leave me alone, you're gonna have to send me home. 'Cause I'm about to whip somebody's ass.
Oh.
What is that? I love it.
It's called I'm About to Whip Somebody's Ass. You were just whipped our relationship asses. All I'm saying that I love your passion, Karen Turner. I love it. I love it. And if we can put a man on the moon, we can put one on you. So it's going to happen. It's going to happen.
I think I need my own show. I think I need to tell the women of Essence just what it TI
right?
is. That's what I think.
Well, we're going to be doing our Nancy Drew show, you and I.
All right, bring on the next one. I'm hot.
I think we're onto something. So you are hot. Now, number three. Hot, like a hot tamale. Number three, scanning dating websites is not dating, kids. Scanning dating websites is not dating. Online dating is totally okay, but only if your web search leads to dates. Devote some time to actually getting to know a few of your matches in the real world. The perfect partner may not look perfect on paper, so make sure you're meeting men in person. Now, I have to agree and disagree with this. Well, because I met Luke on OkCupid, and we did, you know, we spent some time getting to know each other, you know, on the phone and all that kind of stuff and through the site and all that. But we had a handful of dates. We took it, we did each step, and we made it real. So, but what do you think about that? Scanning
It sounds like you're not disagreeing at all with them. It sounds like that's exactly what they're saying should happen.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I think you're agreeing 100%. And I would agree 100%. One thing that I have noticed, putting myself back out there, is that men, gay men, are, and I can't speak for straight men, gay men are lazy as hell. They want to have a relationship via text. One of the first guys I went out with, you know, when I put myself back out there, we had an amazing date, 3 hours at a restaurant. We talked. We had a great time. We were really, really just attracted to each other in every way possible. We had driven separately. You know, we sort of lived far from each other. Not too far, but like, you know, 20, 25 minutes, whatever. And so we were like, you know, that was the end of the date. And we were just like, we got home. We texted each other. We had such a great time. We want to see each other again, blah, blah, blah. The rest of the week, it was like, he texted me 25, 30 times a day. It got into sexting. And at first I was like, wow, this guy, you know, is really attentive, whatever. But then every time I tried to move it to another, you know, actual in-person encounter, there was always an excuse. And I didn't take it so much as like, okay, you know, not attracted because you know or you don't, you know if somebody is or they aren't. I hope.
Right.
But it was just, it just seems to be like it's a matter of convenience. It's like, great, I found somebody I like, so I don't actually have time to date them, but I can text them, and that's a relationship. And no, it isn't. You know, it's complete bullshit is what it is.
Well, I don't want.
Yeah.
It's like,
yeah.
Figure it out.
Yeah, absolutely.
But I have to agree with you. We have gotten so addicted to this texting. Ladies and gentlemen, if you text me, more than three texts in a row, stop and call. Call me. Let's talk. Let's have a conversation. Let's meet in person. Texting is not conversing, is not relating. It's avoiding. It's avoiding. After so many texts, it's not, I'm right with you on that one. So kudos to you.
Thank you.
Now, number four.
I'm back at you.
Well, back at you. I love your passion. You're a very passionate individual, Kieran. You're just fired
Thank
up.
You.
I hope you're having a cocktail. I hope you are. Yes. Right? Now, number four on our Just the Tip 10 Tips for Dating in Your 30s, 40s, and Beyond is spread the word. I told everyone I knew that I was dating and to please invite me anywhere there could be some guys to meet, says Maureen in Love for Grownups. A friend of a friend introduced her to a nice guy, and her dating PR paid off. She married him a few years later. So spread the word. Are you letting your friends and people around you that you interact with know that you're on the market?
No. Well, that's not true. Yes,
well,
I
now
am.
You are.
No. you're not done. I'm sorry. I thought you were actually asking me that question.
No, I was.
Okay. Essence, you are Essence, Michael. Essence is you. I can't tell where the article ends and you begin.
Yeah.
You are
like
a
Essence
fierce,
of MTG.
Mm-hmm. You're a fierce, strong Blacktress. You are. You really are.
Oh.
You are Angela Bassett.
I knew
you are Taraji
P.
Henson.
P. Henson. Oh, my God. You know, if I wasn't already taken, I'd marry you if I wasn't already taken.
Yeah, you know, I don't know. I think that can sometimes be a problem because, You know, if it doesn't work out, then you've got two friends and you're in the middle, and I don't know. I don't have any kind of a really personal experience with that, so I'm going to abstain from a firm answer.
Honey, if I had a nickel for every time I was in the middle. Oh, hello. Yeah. All right. So we'll move along. Number five. Right. Check your anger at the door. We all know friends who are bitter about ever finding a mate or about being divorced or wronged by men, but being optimistic is the key. Take the time to do some soul searching about your past hurts. Forgive your wrongdoers and open yourself up to finding love again. So, Kieran Turner, have you checked your anger at the door?
Yes, I have. I think I have. At least about that. There's a lot of things I hang on to anger-wise and a lot of things I'm bitter about. But, relationships, no, not one of them. So I think that you have to be a certain kind of optimistic. Even if you're the most negative person in the world, if you're still putting yourself out there and taking chances, mm-hmm. there's obviously got to be, you know, something optimistic about you. I mean, look, I'm one of the most cynical people I know, and you can ask anybody, and they will tell you the same, that I am like a truly just really kind of dark and cynical person. However, if I let it consume me, I wouldn't be doing any of this. I wouldn't, you know, right. That's professionally and personally. So, you know, I certainly think that you should never forget necessarily, but you should not make it such that it stops you from going forward.
Right. Yeah. Well, that's another don't soak in it. It's not palm olive moment. Yeah.
There you go.
So don't forget, but move on. Yeah. Now, number six, hang out with your married friends. Seeing your pals hang out with their hubby should inspire you to be optimistic about dating, and asking for a referral doesn't hurt either. A happily married couple is most likely to fix you up with decent guys because they want others to be as happy as they are. I'm not sure how I feel about this one.
I think whoever wrote this is getting lazy, because that sort of sounds like the one from two questions ago. Yeah.
I was reaching for the cheese cube and the snack crackers on that one.
Also, you know, I know a few married people, and, you know, but they usually have kids, and I don't have kids. I don't want kids. So it's a totally different thing for me. It's like a totally different mindset for me. So personally, I wouldn't condone that. But again, it's something that I suppose if that's what you're after, if you're looking to have that particular kind of domestic bliss, and situation, then sure, why not?
Right. Absolutely. Now, number seven, I think, is really important. I think this is a good one. 10 tips for dating in your 30s, 40s, and beyond. Number seven, know what to overlook, but use your well-developed common sense to detect if it's time to exit stage left. Your gut feelings about a guy are usually right.
Amen.
Thank you. Amen. Exactly, is exactly right, because you need to pay attention. Pay attention to your gut instincts. Yeah, if you see a red flag, kids, don't go, ooh, pretty red. I love red. No, it's a red flag. Run.
Yep.
Yeah.
And I would say that you should use that strategy for everything, not just relationships, not just romance, everything. Your gut is the best thing that you have. If you have a strongly developed gut, you'll go very far.
Well, right now I have a very strongly developed gut, and I'm trying to work it out at the gym. So that
I'm saying.
Yeah. Now, number eight, speaking of, on the heels of know what to overlook and to recognize if it's bad to run away, number eight is recognize a keeper. Your grown-up smarts will help you recognize the fundamental qualities you seek in a life partner. No, he may not be the Adonis he was in his 20s, but if he's dependable considerate, and you share the same values, he might just be the one for you. What do you think about that?
I'm so glad we got to this question because my passion was flagging. I have to be honest. I was kind of checking out.
Oh, don't let your passion flag.
I know, but I'm going to say bullshit.
Oh yeah.
Who the hell wants to spend the rest of their life with some dullard just because they're dependable? You gotta click.
I love you. This is what you do with those guys. Yeah.
Sorry.
You're dull.
Yeah, sure. Exactly.
They shoot dullards, don't they? You know, not horses, dullards.
Yeah, you know who I depend on? I depend on me. I don't need anybody else to depend on.
Oh, my God, you're a spitfire. I love you. I love it. Oh, I love it. You're the world's oldest ingenue. You are. You ought to marry yourself, Jill. Look in that mirror and go, you know what? I'd go out with you. You look in that mirror and that's what you say to yourself. I'd do you. You know,
I'm
going to
write a one-man screwball comedy for myself.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's going to be our companion piece to Nancy Drew. Okay. Number nine, confide with care. You might agree with this one. Confide with care. Dating when you're older may involve dealing with men who have children, well, not for you, exes, and long-term personal affairs. It's a lot to take in when you first meet someone, so be sure to set a realistic timeline on when to divulge your life's details with each other. Oh, I'm a little uncomfortable with this one. Really? Confide
Why
with
that?
Care? When are you going to wait until the wedding day to go, by the way, I've been married 9 times and I have 18 kids?
I don't know that's what they're necessarily saying.
Are you sure?
I think so, and I'm gonna cite one of my own episodes of Wallflowers here.
Oh, I love it. Please do.
See how I bring it full circle, Michael? Do you see what a professional does? They bring it full
TV.
Circle.
Yeah, right? Stage17.tv/shows/Wallflowers.
In season 2, episode 2, Bryce goes out on a date with Alex. It's like their first like major date,
and he's
you know,
such a good
Alex
actor.
Is what?
Mm-hmm. He's such a good actor.
Yeah, he is a very good actor. But, you know, basically Alex is just diarrhea of the mouth. This happened and this happened and this happened. And then he turns to Bryce and says, you know, your turn to spill all your secrets, you know, last horrible relationship. And Bryce just basically says to him, you know, I don't do that. I used to do it. I used to think that if I told people about all the shit that I went through, that it would make me seem more human. And all it really does is it makes you seem weak. And I believe that to an extent. I believe that people don't want to – it's not that they want to keep their heads in the sand. It's that, you know, they don't want to be confronted with, you know, with all of your shit. What are they going to do with it? They're not your shrink. You know, it's like ease it out. Let it out a little bit at a time and when you need to. You know,
I don't want to hear about your exes. You know, if you're Latham with Taylor, Hilton, Wilding, Todd, Fisher, Burton, Warner, Potensky, I don't want to hear about all of your exes on your first date.
Yeah, there you go.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so,
absolutely.
No, I think it's so allow yourself to enjoy each other and enjoy the finer points of each other. And then as it goes along, you'll open up and reveal more and more about your life, you know. So, no, I think that's a very, very good point. Now, number 10. Because
oh, my God, we're at 10 already?
We're all right, number 10 already on our show. Our just, what do you mean? Oh, is that all sarcasm?
This list has been longer than the butler. Come on.
Please don't tell you that. Just a tip, 10 tips for dating in the 30s, 40s, and beyond. Number 10, have fun. Your older years made you wiser and more adventurous, so try a tango lesson. Hike a nature trail, or write a web series called Wallflowers, because just because you've been around the block a few times doesn't mean you can't make dating a blast. Like spending some time with Kieran Turner.
Mm-hmm. I would agree with that, although the examples that they cite are like super, super like old fogey. But
Except for writing a web series, which I added. I was very, that was my improv skills coming to light.
I agree. But, you know, but there's also a danger in that, and I fall into this trap sometimes, too. It's like if I want to, if I go out with somebody, like I want to, like, I want to find something, like, sort of offbeat and different. You know, like I don't want to sit in the movie. You know, it's like, to me, that's not a date. So That's not a date.
Yes, thank you for bringing that up. That is not a date. If it's early on in your relationship, do not go to a movie because you're going to sit there for 2 hours or so not talking to each other, really.
Right.
What, so you can
the first date, like dinner is fine because you're getting to know each other. But then like the second date, like I feel like I always like feel pressure to like do something that like somebody wouldn't necessarily do because that's kind of who I am. You know, it's like I like to try and find offbeat things to do. And so I, you know, I try to like do that for dates, but then I always feel like, am I trying too hard? Am I like looking like I'm trying to impress somebody too much? And it's, you know, dating sucks.
So what do you do on that second date that most people don't do? What do you do? Take them to your dungeon?
I look for things that are happening in the city that you might not necessarily think of doing. You know, there's always something interesting. Well, not always. I mean, most of the times there's something interesting happening, you know, especially if it's a weekend. Sometimes if it's during the week, you're shit out of luck. But, you know, and it's just I really like try and find something that, you know, you like people wouldn't necessarily expect.
Like, you know, Occupy L.A., you go to downtown and outside the city hall and you live in a tent for a week.
Okay. Well, you know, it's more like a snake handler, you know, like sermon on a Sunday morning or something like that, you know, something fun.
Wow. Well, take note, ladies and gentlemen, take note, guys out there, us single gay men, take note, do something fun in that second date with Kieran. I want to hear about it.
Well, just do something fun in a second date. It doesn't have to be with me. I don't want to date all of you.
Well, why not, you know, stay busy. Better busy than bored, Kieran. Better busy than bored. Okay. Now, we are heading towards the stretch here on the show, and this is the end of our show, but we always love to end with music. In our Jukebox 5 segment, well, this week's Jukebox 5 selections are all inspired by our deliciously talented featured guest, Kieran Turner. Okay, and I want you to, because these all were inspired by you and your wonderful web series, Wallflowers. And number 5 of our Jukebox 5 is one of your favorite songs of all time by The Style Counselor. So let's take a sip of our cocktail and slip into something comfortable by The Style Counselor with their My Ever-Changing Moods.
My theme song. Thank you.
You're welcome. It's a little bit of a lead-in, so take a sip of that cocktail right now. Song, My Ever-Changing Moods.
Yes.
Style Counselor. Now, what is it about that song? It's from 1984, and written by The Style Council, My Ever-Changing Moods. So how does it I have a feeling I know why it captures Kieran Turner, My Ever-Changing Moods. You tell us.
I'm a Gemini. What can I say?
Oh, when's your birthday?
It's actually next week, next Thursday, June 5th.
Oh, I'm June 20th. Oh. No wonder we get along so well. Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah. So happy early birthday to you. Right.
Same to you, darling.
That's right. We may turn in each other. I love you. I hate you. So, yeah. So,
but it'll be over soon.
That's
we'll,
true.
We'll be
true.
Back to loving each other.
Not soon enough. No, here we go. Now, number four of our jukebox five is from Joe Bryas, because I thought it only appropriate since you did since you've been in this wonderful documentary with Joe Bryas, A.D. This is from Joe Bryas' legendary 1974 live performance on the Midnight Special on NBC, hosted by Gladys Knight. This is Rock of Ages. Love it. Rock of Ages, Joe Bryas. Now, tell us. I encourage everybody to go on YouTube and check out that particular video from the Midnight Special on NBC, 1974, hosted by Gladys Knight. But you've also captured that as part of your documentary, Joe Bryas, AD. So are we able to catch that on Netflix or where can we see that? I mean, it's been released, I know.
Yes. Now, the best place to see it is on VOD. We did our theatrical run. We haven't done our DVD Netflix streaming yet. That's going to come later on in the year. But we're up on iTunes and Amazon and Vudu and all of those other VOD places. So you can get it there.
Okay.
And,
so you can go to Amazon Plus
it.
Or whatever and do that. Oh, good.
Yeah.
Okay, awesome. Look forward to watching that. Now, as we move along in our Jukebox 5 segment, and noting earlier how we sling hash to do our web series and all the other things that we do as creatives here, me doing my show here, OMTG, and you doing your documentaries, your films, and now your web series, Wallflowers, Donna Summer said it best, and she's one of my favorite gay icons ever. Even though she was straight, to me, she's a gay icon. She works hard for the money. I just, This song just came to mind because, you know, when I was a kid, I had a Donna Summer poster on my wall in my bedroom, which probably brought a lot of consternation to my parents. But that's okay. That's okay. She meant a lot to me. And I think of your characters in Wallflowers and how hard they all work at everything that they do. You know,
speaking of working, I just want to tell you that during that last music break, I was just got off the phone with Essence.com, and I'm their new relationship guru. So,
I love it. You are a multitasker, Karen Turner. You are just amazing. I love it. Now, speaking of working hard for the money, you know, it doesn't matter how long you're at it. You can't give up. Okay. Now, and this next artist, this is his first album release in 18 years, and he, for me, again, was another gay icon. Because, you know, we're supporting our community here, Kieran.
Mm-hmm.
We're supporting our community here. This is Boy George.
Oh, right.
And he has a new album.
Who would that be? But yes, the wonderful.
Right. Boy George has a new album entitled This Is What I Do. And I like this particular song because it's called Nice and Slow. And like I said, in the theme of working, where we're talking about relationships and about wallflowers, don't rush people. Don't feel that you have to take on anybody else's kind of agenda. If you need to take it nice and slow, you do so. So to embrace that particular theme, here's Boy George to help us take it nice and slow.
Time to breathe. Good morning, Mr. Lovebone. How you doing today? Tell me. Well, I'm just like Pepsi. I got my sparkle back again. I've been talking less, thinking more. Feel like I should hold you inside.
Nothing I need to do but take it nice and slow. How do you feel about that?
Had you not told me that was Boy George, I would have never guessed that. That doesn't sound anything like him.
I know. I have to say, I think he hung out with Whitney for a while. Too soon.
Mm.
Yeah, I can tell it's him, but there's so much gravel in his throat. I think he's going to pave a new street. I know. It's like, ooh, this is what I did. It should be the title of his album, not This Is What I Do. But yeah, that's okay. I'm not bitter. But I do love him so. And I appreciate that he's out there and he's trying to embrace. He really is embracing where he's been. And he's putting into his work. So, you know, kudos to him, because he was a big part of my youth as far as musical influences. So I appreciate the fact that he's still out there. Now, in fully embracing Wallflowers and the dating scene, and we did mention this because this was in the very first of our top 10 Just a Tip Dating in Your 30s, 40s, and Beyond. Saying goodbye to good for now relationships, but you didn't so much agree with, because you're like, it's okay to have the booty call. And I hear you. But this is for those who want to put a ring on it. Ladies and gentlemen, single ladies and gentlemen, Miss Beyonce. If you like it, then you should put a ring on it, Karen Turner. Could be a cock ring, could be a hand ring. You decide.
I think those were wise choices.
Thank you. You're so supportive.
You're very welcome.
I love it. You can't, if you can't be an athlete, be an athletic supporter. I love it. You've got a great attitude, Karen Turner. I just want to give a big OMTG thank you to our featured guest this week, Mr. Karen Turner, the wonderfully talented and entertaining creative that he is. Now, for more information about our shows, guests, and topics, just go to facebook.com/OHMTG. Remember to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter and Spreaker.com, and share with everyone you know. Thanks for tuning in to OMTG. We are broadcasting a lively, sparkling new show every Wednesday, every week. So tune in, turn on, and live an authentic life. Karen, you have been a sheer ornery delight. I love it.
I had a great time. Thank you for having me.
Thank you. And we look forward to hearing much more about all the wonderful projects that you're doing and about this new amazing show called Nancy Drew that you're doing. You're going to do with OMTG. Have a good night.
You too. Bye-bye.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.